Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening for another very special edition of WOWSA Live with our host, Ned Denison, and a very special guest. Ned?
Hello, everyone. I'm the chairperson of the International Marathon Swimming Hall of Fame. Our guest today has the unique honor of being in at least three different halls of fame. He is in the International Marathon Swimming Hall of Fame, the International Swimming Hall of Fame, the International Ice Swimming Hall of Fame, and he's one of the very generous donors to the Marathon Hall of Fame, and he's a gold patron. So thank you very much, Petar Stoychev from Bulgaria. First question, Petar. At about age 20, you competed in your first international open water marathon. How did you even know about this? Who advised you? How did this all happen?
It happened a long time ago when I was 17 years old. There was a friend of mine just asking me a question, why you don't swim in these long races? Why you only swim a pool or Bulgarian short marathons like 3-4 kilometers? Well, I said, it's too much. I don't know if I can do that. But we find a way that there is a competition in Macedonia, in Lake Ohrid. And I get the chance to be accepted in 93 as one of the swimmers that year. And really, by luck, I finished second at that event. And so I said, it sounds good to keep on doing these marathons. But the beginning was really, really difficult. At that time, I had to do a visa for every country I want to go. And to get a visa, I need to get invitation, which sometimes, if there is no fax, they have to be by letter. Sometimes the letter takes more than a month from the organizing committee to my home and back another month. So it was a really difficult beginning, but once we set up the paperwork and when I set up my team, it was easier to start really racing in 1998 to cover all the circuit around the globe. So at the age of 22, I start doing a full circuit around the globe.
You have unbelievably been in four Olympics. Can you compare your nerves, your excitement, your first Olympics compared to your first marathon swim?
Well, it was probably one of the most exciting trip for me from Bulgaria to Sydney 2000. It take us over 40 hours to reach the Olympic city of Sydney. And that was one of my targets at age of 24, to be an Olympian, to participate at the Olympic Games. I knew it, that my passion is open water swimming and marathon swimming. But at that time, unfortunately, the only chance for me to swim at the Olympic Games was 1500 meters and 400 free. Well, there was a time limits by Bulgarian Swimming Federation at that time. I don't remember if FINA start setting time limits a year later, I believe. Olympic Games later in Athens, 2004. But in Sydney, the time limits were set by the Bulgarian Federation. So I had the chance to set up those time limits. And I had the dream, I reached my dream to swim in Sydney. Well, that happened in 2000, before 9/11, 2001, the world was different. We flew everyone together in the plane, the back part of the plane were smoking part, I remember, 24 hours there with everybody smoke around. Once we landed in Sydney Airport, I was so tired from... we changed the season, actually. It was end of the summer and the beginning of spring in Sydney. Time difference, of course, a new world. We don't know what to expect, Olympic Games. I will never forget this enjoyable moment in the beginning of the new century. Of course, my results were not that satisfying in Sydney, but... You know, we need to start from somewhere.
In your marathon career, you have this something which will never happen again. You won the Grand Prix championships 11 times in a row, and you have an unbelievable record at Lac Saint Jean. I'm gonna have you tell me what that number is, because I don't have that many fingers. How much of this dominance was physical ability compared to your mental strength?
Well, let's clear the question, because before 2007, the World Cup were together, the long one and 10 kilometers. 2007, they were separated. So of those 11s, I have half of them together with 10Ks and the long one. But, that was the only chance for me to be happy and to keep on doing extremely hard training sessions. No one open water swimmer, I believe you spoke with most of them, will tell you that the training session is the easiest part. The easiest part is the race. The competition is the easiest part. The hard part of the job is the training session. Every day, early in the morning, and then afternoon again, and that's repeating 11, 12 times per week with very high volume of kilometers. And sometimes, if you are not motivated, it comes to the point that you just wanted to quit and you don't want to go to the pool anymore. But probably the energy I get from the victories, the energy I get from all the friends I met around the globe, and of course with all the friendship with the organizers and everybody I know from swimming, give me that power and that motivation to keep on going so many years and, of course, so many thousands of kilometers. And probably that at every start, I had in my mind only positive thinking of winning the race, of being first at that race. I have never think the other way. I never think for the second place. I never think for be a retire during the swim. Probably that was the small secret and difference comparing to all my opponents. But being positive and being focused during the race, when it's so many waves around you, cold water, boats crossing in front of you, making waves, it's not so easy. Because, of course, we are humans, and when we feel difficulties and our inside protection just saying, stop, don't do this anymore, it's hard. But I just had the luck to be more strong than the rest.
Was year number 11 more difficult than year number 5?
Well, year number 11, it was just a sign that it's coming the end. And I believe that 2012, when I decided to be focused only in the Olympic Games in London, if I was swimming the World Cup, I believe I would win easily 2012 as well as a 12th trophy. But in one stage, it comes a moment where I wanted to win, let's say, Olympic Games. Unfortunately, I couldn't do it, but that was part of the game. But I will always remember the first victory, 2001, and the last one. I will not remember clearly the fifth, as you said, because it was part of the game.
In Beijing, you carried the flag for the Bulgarian team. Describe the pride at a moment like that.
It was a lot in the media before the Olympic Games that the first time in the history open water swimming is going to be part of the Olympic program. And Bulgaria has a good swimmer and a chance to make a good performance at that event. I get the support from the president of Bulgarian Olympic Committee. She talked to me. She asked me, do you want to carry the flag? Because some of the athletes believe that if they carry the flag at the opening ceremony, it means bad luck and they're going to be a tyrant for the next days. But of course, you know how is the thinking of the professional athletes. they don't want to waste they don't want to waste energy for something on the side. But I said no. I would like to carry the flag. That's gonna be an honor for me, representing my country at the Beijing Olympics. That was the 8th of August, 08. That was 3 times 8, and I will always remember that that moment. The full stadium with over 100,000 people on the field, on the stage, on the surrounding around the pool, around the stadium. Amazing feeling at that opening ceremony. And of course, everyone who watched us now and representing, being flag bearer of his own country, will probably share the same opinion as me.
If the Olympics were 25K and not 10K, what do you think would have happened?
Well, that's why it's good to have a competition in Olympics, and that is the difference between the professional competition, the Olympic Games, that we all know what is the distance, when is going to be, which date and what time. So everyone who is ready for this must be prepared for that day, for that moment. I don't care if it's going to be 5K, 10K or 25. That was important, important day, and every professional swimmer must to be prepared for the events, which is set up by the federation, by the IOC as well. If there was 25, probably I would have double the chances to do a better performance. Of course, I like it more longer distances, but still 10K, it's a king event for the best open water swimmers. And if I had to take the decision which is going to be the Olympic open water event, I will say 10K, because it's a extremely difficult swim. You must swim for 2 hours with very high intensity. You must be for 2 hours in the perfect position. And the last 1K, you need to just start extremely fast to finish the race in the good position. And for pushing hard 2 hours, it's not an easy job.
Tell us what you changed in your training for the games in London. You stopped the Grand Prix circuit in anger. Were your pool sessions shorter? Were they more intense? What did you do differently to prepare for those games?
Oh, I did many different things. First of all, at the end of 2010, I moved my family to Germany. So I moved from Bulgaria to Germany to have a chance to train with the best open water swimmer in our history. I would say a friend of mine, Thomas Lurz, and his brother, one of the probably the best open water coach in the beginning of our new century. Thomas and Stefan, there was extremely good team with a very very well set up training sessions, with a very good swimming club, 50 meters swimming pool, with good gym and everything, which a professional marathon swimmers need. And that was the big change of my life, moving to Germany with a totally different way of living. As you know, the people are focused only on their job and nothing else matter. From the funny life here in Bulgaria, I had to move at age of 34, 35 to Germany with my wife, my daughter. But that was the price of the game at that moment. I start training with Thomas. We had an excellent team there. And of course, had the chance to become the world champion the year later, 2011 in Shanghai. And that's because of Thomas and Stefan. They helped me so much at that moment.
So I might think that Thomas Lurz was one of your biggest competitors in your career. And he and his brother welcomed you into their program.
Yeah, that's the reality. They welcomed me in Würzburg to be together with them. Long time ago, as a junior swimmer, I raced with Stefan at the Junior European Championships when he was a swimmer. And in Athens, I believe, I swam against Thomas in 1500. So we know each other from the past, but I knew it that Thomas is much faster than me. At that moment, he was 3 years younger than me. He's still 3 years younger than me, but at that time is matter very much that age. I was 36 in London, quite old for the field in Serpentine, but that was part of the game.
And when you were training with Thomas, was it a war every session? Were you trying to swim faster than him every time? Was he trying to swim faster?
The problem when you train with Thomas, anyone who trains with Thomas, he has the same problem. We push with Thomas 2-3 training sessions really hard. At the fourth training session, you are dead totally. And Thomas keep on pushing. He gets never tired. Thomas was always, everything was so easy for him. No, he was never tired in the gym, in the pool. He was pushing crazy nonstop. Unbelievable guy. That's why he was, I still believe he deserved to be an Olympic champion. Much more than anybody else. He was an extremely good swimmer.
I read that Thomas was going to the pool on Christmas Day to train because he knew that no one else was going to the pool on Christmas Day. Do you believe the story, and were you there with him?
Well, this is a reality. When I was in Germany, we even swam the morning of Easter. We skip only the afternoon. He's a workaholic guy. Do you know what? The start of the training session, it's always with the far end of the pool. But by the rules in Germany, we had to take shower every time we go to the pool. But the shower were the other side of the pool. So we walk 50 meters, take shower, and the training session starts with 100 easy. We always started with 50 easy and doing 10 kilometers, let's say, session. And once we finished the 10 kilometer session, Thomas were swimming till 25 and back to complete the first 50 he missed from the training session. And I asked him, what are you doing, man? We did 10K. He said, no, I have 12 training sessions a week. And 12 times 50 meter less, it's 600 meters per week. If you multiply 50 times per year, it comes a big amount of kilometers. So that's why he was a real champion, yes.
For those of you who aren't familiar with Thomas, his biography is on the website. He is the most decorated medalist in the history of open water swimming. Petar, at one point you became a minister in the Bulgarian government for sport. How did it happen? What did you learn? What was your biggest surprise? And if they ask you to be prime minister someday, are you going to say yes?
Well, look, it comes naturally. That happened in continuing of our conversation about Germany. That happened in the beginning of 2013. One day, I came back home from training session with Thomas. It was like 9 o'clock in the morning, Monday. I get call from the government and they ask me that the president wants to talk to me. And I ask, what is the reason? And they proposed me to be a part of caretake government, right? That's the right thing. Because the existing government just resigned. Well, I had to talk to my wife, to my parents, because that was another point in my life. I get enough swimming at that stage after the Olympic Games, 9th place in London. If I've been in top 8, I would be in the program for the next 4 years, supporting by the Bulgarian government for the Olympic Games in Rio 2016. 2016. But unfortunately, I finished eight. So out of this top, I finished nine out of this top eight. So I said, it will be hard to continue another 4 years. I'm going to be 4 years old. And that was opportunity for me to quit with swimming. And one day when I asking myself, why you stop? I would say, because I became a sport minister and that was the reason to stop with hard training session. And I got the feeling that I couldn't push so much with Thomas. He wanted to, every time he emptied all my energy during the training session. So I said, it's time to stop now. That was the reason, just, I don't know.
If the president called you tomorrow and said he wants you to take his place, would you?
No. It's not so. It's not. The other part of the question was what I learned. I learned that the reality, the life of the active athletes, the professional athletes, it's completely different than the life behind the desk, the life with the papers and the documents. It's absolutely different, another world. So I believe when I got more free time, more freedom to travel and meet people, it's a better life for me. To wear an official suit and be a non-stop in the meetings, it's probably hardest part of the life for me.
It is said that the worst jobs, the worst words for swimmers are things like desk and job. So maybe you're correct. You set the English Channel record a few years ago. Congratulations. I also heard stories that when Trent Grimsey was going for the record, you were advising him. Can you tell us about that? Because I think for a lot of people, they can't imagine Thomas, one of your biggest competitors, welcoming you into his swimming pool. They can't imagine you holding the record and helping Trent. So talk to us about that.
If we go a little bit back of history in English Channel, Christo Vandrač from Germany, he set the world record in 2005 with a time of 7 hours and 3 minutes. And Christoph as well is a good friend of mine, and he just advised me that the English Channel is kind of top of the top in the longest swims, because the water is cold and it's unpredictable weather there in Dover. And I had the idea to be the first guy swimming the English Channel less than 7 hours. Of course, I get a lot of advices from Christoph. And in 2007, I had the chance to break the 7 hours barrier. Trent, unfortunately, couldn't qualify for the Olympic Games in London. And after qualification passed, he decided to swim in 2012 at the World Cup. Let's say that time was Grand Prix. And he won it, I believe, 2012, the Grand Prix overall. I met him in Lake Ohrid right after the Olympic Games, and he just told me that his plans is to go in England to swim the English Channel. We spoke just a little bit about the channel. I didn't give much advices about that swim. As much as I know, Damian Blount from Argentina, he was in his boat and swam with him at his world record attempt. And Trent was a good swimmer, very tough guy, hard to beat him. And he had a good day, and he swam more than 2 minutes faster than me. So he's now the guy who holded the English Channel World Record. And we have to admire. That's why the records are to be broken.
Mike Oram told us a great story about your swim with Yuri just behind you. And you had started a little before him. And Mike said that you were looking and looking and looking, and it looked like Yuri might break your record. Can you remember those 5 minutes after you finished and got back on the boat?
Well, the English Channel history says that it's a single swims, You cannot race there. It have to be a single swim. I booked Mike a long time ago, like 2006. I swam the English Channel first time with 7 hours and 20 minutes with really bad weather. The year later, 2007, when I break the record, I went back with Mike and we start checking the weather and everything. And the Russians were there, Yuri. He was in, of course, a world champion and a really good swimmer in extremely good shape at that time. He was an actual world champion from Melbourne 2007. And of course, he was a potential record breaker. And while I swim, I was motivating myself and saying, imagine you reach France, you break the record, and 20 minutes later, Yuri break the record again. So you're going to be a record holder only for 20 minutes. So you have to push more. You have to push. And I was asking Mike, what's going on? What's going on? And suddenly at the end of the swim, he said, it's okay. You had advantage of him. I reach France. I climb on the rocks. Of course, it took me more than a minute to go out of the water with those big waves there. But I was staying on the rocks until Yuri finishing, and I was counting minutes and say, let's see if it's gonna be faster than me. But hopefully I was lucky that day to get the record. But if we talk about those swim, this swim, we have to say that the weather were extremely bad. The first 2.5-3 hours were, let's say, so-so, but the last four hours, big waves, absolutely not the weather for record. That's why Mike, I will always remember what he says. He says that he will never saw a swimmer like me pushing so hard in that bad condition. And when Trent break the record, he called me and says, Petar, in that condition, you can go about 20 minutes faster. But I said, okay, forget about it. It's a new story now, 2012.
In 40 years' time, what's the record going to be?
Well, probably next year, I'm trying to do North Pole swim. Once I reach this target, editing Antarctica swim 2 years ago, I'm planning to quit with these swims because I have enough pain and enough tough moments in the water, and I would like to enjoy the sunny, nice days and to enjoy my family, because the young generation are coming very, very fast, challenging us. So we need to give way to them to break our records and show us their potential.
And final question, tell us about your current involvement in the sport. I understand you're involved at a local swimming club. What are you giving back to the sport now?
Here in Sofia, the capital of Bulgaria, with my colleagues from swimming club Levski, we're managing the biggest swimming complex in Sofia. We have an Olympic size indoor pool, 25 meter pool, a kids pool with hot water and 70 centimeters deep. And we also have an outdoor swimming pool with a diving tower, 20 by 30 meters, which is also a water polo field. We're trying to provide the best training conditions for our young generation here in the club. We organize two big events every year at the end of May, first week of June. One of the biggest national competition for the kids age 9-10 years old. And every first week of November, we organize the longest traditional event in Bulgaria. This year is going to be the 22nd edition of a swimming tournament. And trying to, of course, cooperate with the government, supporting, of course, kids to teach how to swim, giving opportunity to disabled people to has the chance to reach to make their life easier with the water, and trying to do some educational clinics for referees, and that's all.
I want to thank you very much for your time today. You've been a great champion in several sports now, and we wish you all the best in the future.
Give me the chance to use this opportunity to thank you to all the organizers. The last almost 30 years I have been swimming in open water, because I know all of them personally, and all of them are giving me something to grow up and to be better in my achievements. Of course, I would like to thanks to all my opponents and friends in open water swimming, to Swimming Hall of Fame, to FINA officials and all my friends in FINA. Of course, I have to thanks to Bulgarian Swimming Federation and all my coaches coaching me for those 30 years. And thank you, Ned, for doing this job and keeping our sport and history of our sport alive.